Good morning, brothers and sisters. We hope that you had a good week and are wearing your mask and social distancing. We do ask that you hit the subscribe button so that you will be notified when a new message is released. We thank you once again for tuning in to the Pastor.Faith YouTube channel. We try to bring you in-depth messages using the manuscripts which the King James Bible was originally interpreted from, to give everyone a deeper and clearer view of the Bible. The Bible is a book that was created with the wisdom of God to teach and not to confuse. In the book of James, chapter 1, verse 5 through 6, teaches us, "If any lack wisdom, let him ask of the Lord that giveth to all men liberally." So go with us now into another message, which are recorded at the home church live. Because of the COVID, and some come straight from the desk of the pastor. Come on and follow us with your Bibles. We thank God today for, again, being here. I thank him all the time for the sermons that he gives, and just to take us to another level of understanding of him and some of the things that are going on in the world today. And I believe that we should come to church expecting to learn something, not rehearsing the same old thing over and over again, because there's so much depth in the Bible, in the Word, that you and I, even if we live to be 100, we'll never be able to comprehend. So I'm bringing this message today to you, wanting you just to stop and just to think, because it's completely up to you on your response in your heart to this message. The title of it is, Halloween is Quickly Approaching Again. Halloween is quickly approaching again. And the theme is, where lies your loyalties? Say that with me. Where lies your loyalty? And basically, everyone has to make up their mind what they believe, what they don't believe, and stick to your guns. Now, this time of year is unlike any other in many respects. Every shopping center and grocery store is filled with all sorts of candy, costumes, colorful decorations. In a few short days, children will be parading up and down the streets, disguised as their favorite character, chanting trick or treat, and hold out plastic bags or molded plastic pumpkins in hopes of collecting vast amounts of candy. This will, of course, result in a stomach ache the next day. For Christians, Halloween is perhaps the most difficult holiday with which to deal. Its darker side is so concerning. Yet it holds a bit of charm for us as we remember our own childhood experience with that day. A myriad of questions surround Halloween. Should we participate, accommodate, or vigorously denounce Halloween? When I first started doing research on Halloween, I discovered hundreds of websites with articles, sermons, and editorials condemning the observation of this holiday. In fact, many Christians have taken a very strong stance in opposition to Halloween on the grounds that it supports Satan worship and pagan gods. This places many of us, especially those with children, in an uncomfortable position. How should we as Christians respond to this holiday? Is it sinful and evil or just fun and games? Is it a problem or a potential opportunity to answer questions? It's helpful to view Halloween from the perspective of history. So let's begin this morning with a historical perspective of Halloween. First, we ought to recognize that the American celebration of Halloween draws heavily from Scottish and Irish folk customs that can be directly traced to pre-Christian times and is indeed rooted in ancient Celtic feast of Samhain. Although modern Halloweens can be viewed as nights of roll-licking fun and eerie games, its pagan beginnings were not so innocent. So originally, Halloween was a celebration of the Druids in honor of Samhain, whom they believed to be the Lord of the Dead, and whose festival fell on November 1st. The Druids believed that on the eve of this festival, Samhain, the Lord of the Dead, called together the wicked souls that within the past 12 months had been condemned to inhabit the bodies of animals. The veil, they believe, between the present world and the spirit world, or the world beyond, was pierced, released, demons, witches, and goblins en masse to harass the living. Interestingly, they thought that the cat was sacred because they thought that cats, especially black cats, had once been human beings whose spirits were transferred into the cat as a punishment for their evil deeds, which makes you wonder why they were sacred. What a conspiracy, huh? And it's funny because I've always had heard about black cats. Watch out, that cat, don't go over the same path, turn the car around, go the other way. And I never understood that. But all of these sayings stems from something if we take time to research it. Now, there was a prevailing belief amongst many nations that at death, the souls of good people were taken by good spirits and carried to paradise. But the souls of the wicked men were left to wander in the space between earth and the moon, or consigned to inhabit animals. Typically, the Druids believed that on this one night of the year, the eve of the Samhain festival, the spirits of the dead returned to their original homes along with other ghosts and goblins. Boy, it's all coming together, huh? In order to protect themselves, to make themselves immune to the attacking of demons, people disguise themselves as witches, devils, and ghouls, from whence we derive from the custom of wearing costumes for Halloween. And this is where it all originated from. They also attempted to ward off evil spirits by carving scary and grotesque faces on various gourds and illuminating the candles, including pumpkins. In order to placate the evil spirits, they offered a variety of treats, fruits, vegetables, and other types of food. If the demonic hordes were satisfied, it was believed that they would leave you in peace. But if they were not satisfied, if you didn't offer any treats or your offering wasn't good enough, the ghost would trick you by casting a spell on you and wreaking havoc on your home. This is the tradition of trick or treat. Wow, what a lot of information, huh? So hopefully this is going to leave everyone in a better place in thinking about this holiday. Despite its sinister origins, however, I think we can learn a lot from how the early Christians responded to this Cyrene festival. As Christianity spread throughout the Roman Empire and Europe, many pagans and even Druids converted to Christianity. But listen to this, but they were still very superstitious. They didn't have Bibles back then, and most of them were illiterate. They couldn't read the Bible if it was given to them. So without proper education, many of these new believers brought their old superstitions with them into the church, including their belief in ghosts and goblins. Halloween is quickly approaching once again, and as always, there will be certain Christians who will choose to hide from it and condemn anyone who participates in it, while Christians should certainly stand sharply opposed to pagan and demon worshiping. It doesn't mix. You either are or you're not, for one or the other. We should also remember that our treasure celebrations of Christmas and Easter also have some pagan influences in their origins. The early church dwelt with pagan festivals and celebrations by establishing rival Christian celebrations. And while the world has all but forgotten the Greco-Roman gods of the antiquity, they are annually reminded that Jesus Christ invaded space and time and rose from the grave. So despite what they want to believe, it still was in the back of their mind that Jesus Christ invaded space and time and rose from the grave. Now, as we go on, we'll go on a little bit further, but I just want to remind you, this all has been triggered by Satan, because Satan, you will find out as we go through this, has transformed himself into light. In other words, an imitation of who Jesus Christ is. Because remember, he always wanted to be like him. Have no fellowship with fruitless deeds of darkness. Christians are supposed to be peculiar, set apart, and not conform to the ways of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And you can only get that by reading and studying the Word. As we talked about earlier, there were many that didn't have access to Bibles, and there were many that were illiterate. If they had a Bible, they couldn't read it. So that's why it's important for us today. We're not all illiterate. We can read, we can write. And when you get into a practice of reading the Word and studying it and looking for things that you don't know, so you can be better abraised to the Word of God, you are moving forward. Some of the teachings these days from the pulpit is just mind-boggling. We as Christians are to train our children so that they don't make the same foolish mistakes we made growing up in this world because of lack of teaching. Everyone say, because of lack of teaching. Now, if the Bible is our guide, then no is the simple answer. No is the simple answer. Now, let's go to some supports, some support scriptures. Ephesians 5:11, have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather expose them. Let them know you know who they are. And when others are questioning, let them know that you know that this is not a good thing. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5:22, abstain from all appearances of evil. Move away from it. Get away from it. Don't try to sit down and have a conversation and bargain with them. Some good questions to ask yourself are, does Halloween fill me with faith or fear? When you drive through and see witches hanging up and goblins and all this other stuff, what actually do you immediately feel? Do you feel it's of God, or do you feel it's a force that's against the things that are of God? Yes, Halloween celebrates fear. The theme of darkness, graves, blood, skulls, vampires, witches, and wizards infuse fear. Some of the movies that are out there that you probably have watched, and that includes this reference to it, and you get fearful. If there's someone watching it with you, you embrace and hug, because it's a fearful moment for you. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7, for God hath not given us the spirit of fear. He doesn't want us to be fearful, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Let me tell you something, brothers and sisters. If you get around a circumstance or get around people that are promoting fear, you need to move away, because something's not right. God has given us, and listen, if you don't have the gift, pray for it, the gift of discernment. When you're around people and they don't feel right, move away from them. Move away from them, because there's something to what you're feeling, because you are a child of the living God. And God gives you that spirit of discernment. And don't take it for granted. Move away. When there's knocks come at your door, somebody's at your door, you feel that it's not of a good spirit, move away. When you're on a job and you're doing interviews, things of that nature, you feel the spirit is not right, move away or set that aside. God is giving you an inclination of what's going on. How am I honoring God in this celebration? 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 20. But I say that the things which the Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice to devils and not to God. And I would not that you should have fellowship with devils. And this is the Apostle Paul writing to the church of Corinth that were actually dabbling in these things. I ask the questions, can evil spirits disguise themselves as others? 2 Corinthians 11:14, Paul writes, and no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. Yes, Satan can disguise himself as mellow, as jello, and you say, isn't this person just great? Oh my gracious. And it's a disguise to get your faith and to get your confidence in them so that they can come in from another angle to work their mischief. Should Christians be afraid? Psalms 91, 9 through 11. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, David says, even the Most High thy habitations. There shall no evil, everyone say, no evil, befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways. Now, remembering this is something that you're going to have to rehearse in your mind and in your heart when you feel these things around and about. You've chose the Lord. You chose the Lord to serve him. You chose him to protect you. And in doing this, there shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. Excuse me. For he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways. When you get in trouble, when you're not feeling very delightful, maybe fearful, angels, where are you at? You're supposed to be around here protecting me. God, where are they at? Send them. Give my mind freedom to breathe and to know that everything is okay. As we look at Luke chapter 10, verse 19, behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. So you and I have the power to tread upon these evil feelings, these evil people, and so on and so forth. But we have to exercise it. We got to exercise it. And the Bible says, hide my word in your heart. David spoke that. And what is that about? Try to keep the scriptures as much as you can in here. Because if you're depending on, well, I got it written in my Bible, or I got to look this up, and you forget your Bible, then where are you at? Now we have these smartphones and tablets and things, and we can carry information with us to remind us. Romans 12, 2, and be not conformed to this world. Don't get so caught up in the world that you are comfortable with being a part of it. But be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. Be willing to learn new things about God, about the word that you didn't know, and be willing to accept it, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Our mindset should be, Lord, I just want to do your will. I just want to know more about you. Things that I have ran from, things that maybe were told to me years ago that I've rejected. Help me to understand it, see it, that I may come forward to you. In closing, meditate on God's word, and you will be filled with faith in God and flush out fear. There's not enough room for God in here and fear too. The more of God you get in here, the more the fear has to go. It can't stay. It cannot stay. And this is the will of your Father in Jesus' name. Amen. Today, Father, we honor you and we thank you for the words of wisdom, the words of guidance for all of us, which we sometimes displace. But we are here. We're here to hear. We're here to be guided by your Spirit. And we ask you to hide your word in our heart, that we will not sin against you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for joining us on the Pastor.Faith YouTube channel. We encourage you to have a conversation with God on a daily basis. Not many people take the time out of their schedule to do so. This ministry encourages everyone to receive Jesus Christ into their life as Lord and Savior. You may ask, how do I receive him? Just talk to him, confessing to him as being a sinner and how much you need his help. Asking Jesus into your heart, which is your mind, and in doing so, we then have a covenant with God that when we repent and ask for forgiveness for any of our sins, any time of the day, any hour of the day, that we all commit regularly, God is justified to forgive us of our sins. Let me say, the most challenging moment through this process you will face is receiving that forgiveness. You may not feel comfortable the first time around, but practice makes perfect. Feel free to forgive yourself, knowing that someone loves you deeply as God Almighty. He himself has proven it all by bringing his only begotten Son to take on all our sins as the last sacrifice for mankind. to absorb all of the sins of mankind that we all commit, and still having the power to forgive us. We love you and look forward to meeting you and sharing the next message. Hey, don't forget to hit the subscribe button to be notified when the next message is released and posted. God bless you. Till next time. His holy name.
His holy, bless His holy, His wonderful, wonderful name. He's brought us from a long, long way.
Bless His holy name.